shadow. Your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe again. So I fight on my knees with the hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I see through the night. Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And no mighty fortress, you go before.
Building our lives in the foundation of Jesus Christ, no, it's like building our houses on solid rock. Or knowing that the storms, you know, life, there's always storms, there's always battles. But knowing what will come, no, we'll stand strong in Him, knowing that He's on our side, knowing that we have a strength through Christ. So let's just worship with our hearts today. And for he is worthy of our voices. He is worthy of our hearts. So let's sing together.
Worthy of every song we could ever.
every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus' name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Jesus, we will never be shaken. Lord, as we hold on to your promise, building a life around you, it doesn't make life better, but it makes us better at life. Lord, it makes us to have better decisions. It gives us peace throughout the storm. Lord, as we continue our service today, may the people be encouraged by your word, and just prepare our hearts and ears today, Lord God, as we listen. Lord, we love you. We glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It's a great Sunday morning, and we are so excited to have you with us online for our service. My name is Liz, one of the volunteers here at Quest, and our mission is to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. If you feel led to support this mission, you can help by giving financially. Our giving details is at our website, give.questcebu.com. If you have some prayer requests, you can send your prayers at the number below. Do you remember your first job? Why did you take it? To make money? Because your parents made you? Or was it because you realized work was a platform for a greater purpose? It seems the majority of us are working for the weekend. But if we change how we see the purpose of work, it might just change the pleasure we derive from it. Here is part 4 of our video message series, How to Get Life Right, with Gavin Adams.
Working on it. Smiley face.
On my way.
Tommy.
No, the numbers. Really, dude? You just gonna volunteer me like that?
Okay. That should do it. I'm in the clear.
Such a slacker! You know what, Eric? Why don't you just admit you're scared?
What? I'm not scared, I just don't want to do it.
I'm taking point. Don't worry about a thing, Dr. Sweaty.
What? I have a thyroid problem, Tommy. Okay, I'm taking point. You can get my coffee.
What?
Caramel macchiato, venti, skim, extra shot.
Did you just text me your Starbucks order? Okay. The investors would need your coffee, Eric, so you don't put them to sleep.
Okay. Oh, come on. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, emoji wars. Okay, is that what we're doing?
Frowny face, crazy face, sweaty face.
Bomb, syringe. How about another syringe?
Crying face, heart. Sweaty face.
Poop.
Poop.
Sorry, ma'am. I'm sorry.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no.
So stupid. Hey, so just really quick, how many of you have ever sent a text to somebody by accident, like you sent it to the wrong person? Anybody done it like in a really embarrassing way? Yeah, what happened? I'm just kidding, don't tell us. Several years ago, somebody on our staff did that. They were sending a text to their wife, but they actually sent it to our group text message for our leadership team. And when I first got it, I opened the phone and I'm like, oh my gosh, I gotta fire this person. Look what they just said. And then they were like, oh, I'm sorry, that was not meant for you, it was meant for my wife. And I was like, oh, cool, like, way to keep the fire alive, man, like, way to go, you know? So You know, I thought, we're going to promote him, not just fire him. That's pretty impressive. So anyway, if you've ever done that, at least one of our staff members can feel your pain. It's pretty amazing. So, hey, I'm really excited about this last day in the series, How to Get Life Right. Today, we're going to talk about work. And to kind of get started, I want to take us back to 1981. There was this incredible band in 1981 called Loverboy. Anybody remember Loverboy? A lot of you weren't born in 1981. That's cool. Loverboy, they really look amazing. I mean, they're brilliant. They kind of have their act together here. Loverboy, or as I was a kid in 1981, I remember on the radio when they said their name on Power 99 FM in Atlanta here, they would always say, Loverboy. Remember that? I don't know. I think it was a contractual thing. Like, they had to say it like that. Loverboy. So Loverboy, 1981, released a song called Everybody's Working for the Weekend. Anybody remember that song? Man, I'll tell you what, I was 7 years old when that song came out. I'm 44 now, I'll do the math, okay, for you. So I was 7 years old when that same song came out, and I remember thinking, I feel you, lover boy, I get it. I mean, I got chores too, I gotta work, I gotta take the trash out like every other week if I don't forget, I gotta pick up my underwear every once in a while, make a bed once a week. I mean, every day, take a bath. My parents were like, every night, take a bath, take a bath. I'm like, I'm working for the weekend, like, I get it, you know? And what's interesting is that this song is so spot on. Like, I'm not sure if they did a bunch of research and kind of statistical analysis. I mean, they look like mathematicians if you look at them. So I'm not sure how they arrived at the theory behind the song, but it is spot on. It is so accurate. Did you know that the Gallup organization has done some research on work? And this is incredible. What percentage, like in your mind for a second, what percentage of people would you say are dissatisfied at their job? You don't have to yell it out. Just think about it for a minute. Like, what would you guess? What percentage would be dissatisfied? It's unbelievable. You ready for this? 80% of people. 80% of people. Anybody say 80? Yeah, that's because you're dissatisfied. You know, right? 80% of people. 80% of people say that they are dissatisfied in their job. And a bunch of those people have changed jobs, they've gone to other jobs, and, you know, everywhere they go, there they are. But it isn't that they're the problem, it's that, well, work is the problem. I mean, we're just kind of working for the weekend. It's so hard to know how to get out of that grind and make work something better than just kind of like, here we go again. 80% of people dissatisfied with their job. You know what I think? I think that actually might break 100% of God's heart, because I don't think that he wants us to feel dissatisfied. But it's important that we figure this out. You know why it's so important? And I don't know if you've thought of this before, but over the course of your adult working life, you're gonna spend about 90,000 hours at work. I mean, at $8 an hour. No, I'm just kidding, I don't know. But that's a lot of time. Like, that is a lot of time at work. And your adult life, it's about a third of your adult life, you're gonna be spent at work. That's an awful lot of time to be dissatisfied, an awful lot of time to be frustrated or sad. We're depressed. There's a lot of time to just be working for the weekend. That's a lot of Mondays, people. A lot of Mondays to be going into work not excited about what the week holds in store for you. I don't think that's kind of what God wants for us, to be honest. But in a way, it's also our fault. And when I say it's our fault, actually, I mean it's kind of like Adam and Eve's fault, not just our fault. I mean, they're really the ones who messed this whole work thing up. If you go to the beginning of the Bible, Genesis kind of account, the beginning of time, kind of as God's creation account, you see very quickly that things seemed great for about a day. I mean, it didn't take long for things to go really sideways on us. In fact, by chapter 3, Adam and Eve have ruined everything, and we're still living out of what they did in chapter 3. And it affects work, not just everything. In fact, let me show you exactly how it affects work. In chapter 3 in the book of Genesis, the author says to Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife, don't read more into that than you should, okay? But because you listened to your wife and you ate the fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. There's a consequence for this sin. Here's the consequence. Cursed is the ground because of you. Now, not because of me, you know, God, but you, Adam, Eve, because of what you've done, because you rebelled against me. You have entered into the world a curse that will never be lifted until I come back later. So cursed is the ground because of you. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles, which I guess weren't there in the beginning for you. And you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, You will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return. Real positive message there, right? Now, what's so great about this little passage is that it really does explain a lot of things, doesn't it? Like this passage explains my entire yard, in a way. It also explains my very first job. And it explains my second job and my third job, right? I bet it explains a lot of our jobs. At least 80% of us would say that that explains our jobs. Because when we think about work, we don't think about positive, warm, and fuzzy things. We think about, oh my gosh, how quickly can we get to Friday? We're working for the weekend. Like, we're dissatisfied. We have no passion. But it wasn't supposed to be that way. In fact, if you go back one chapter in Genesis, you see God's original design for the world, but also his original design for work. And if we could somehow figure out a way to reclaim that or live out of that, you know, kind of original idea for work, I think it could maybe make Mondays a lot better. It could make Monday something that we look forward to, not that we're just trying to survive and get through. If you go back one chapter to Genesis chapter 2, look at what kind of God says about the world and about work specifically. He says, "This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created, when the Lord God made the earth and the heavens." So that's the setup. Here's what he says. So no shrub had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not sent rain on the earth. And there was, this is cool, no one to work the ground. There's that word work, right? But eventually, streams came up. God caused that to happen from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground, we read about that earlier, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. Now, check out what happens next. Now, the Lord God had planted a garden in the east in Eden, and there he put the man that he had formed. And in this garden, in this Eden, the Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. And then in the middle of the garden were two trees, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So God creates this like spectacular all-inclusive resort, basically, okay? Like, it's the coolest place you could ever imagine. Have you ever been like to an all-inclusive resort or a cruise or something like that? Or maybe like you've seen a picture of it and you've dreamed about it. I mean, it's so cool, right? And God takes Adam and he puts him in the middle of this resort. He gives him the wristband. He's like, this is unlimited. You can have whatever you want. It's all plants right now, but you know, you like it, you garden burgers and stuff. It's probably, you know, soft serve. I mean, it's really cool. And so he's like living it up in the middle of this whole thing. And he can have anything he wants except for the fruit from these two trees. And of course, that's eventually what they do. And we find ourselves at Genesis chapter 3, but it's in the middle of this kind of incredible resort, this just most spectacular place you could ever imagine, that God places Adam. And it was almost built for him, but not just to enjoy. It was bigger than that. It had a bigger purpose than that. In fact, if you go down a few verses, you kind of see a little bit of what that purpose looked like. Verse 15 says this, that the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. Now, because we're on the other side of Genesis chapter 3, when we read this, we're like, oh, that kind of stinks, you know? Like, too bad God didn't put Adam in Eden just to kind of enjoy it. Like, why do you have to go and make him work in it? Like, couldn't he just go vacation? Couldn't it just be a perpetual Saturday, like forever Saturday, kind of like when you're on vacation? Couldn't he just vacation in Eden? I mean, why has he got to work it? But here's what's so interesting. When God put Adam in the Garden of Eden to work it, it wasn't like it was a bad thing. We hear the word work and we think, stinks. But that's because we're on the bad side of Genesis chapter 3. If we could go back before to Genesis 2, if we could kind of enter into that world for a minute, we wouldn't hear the word work and think, ah, bummer. We would hear the word work and go, oh, cool. I'm so grateful. I'm so glad we have Monday. Because work was intended to be something really dynamic. In fact, it was intended to be something amazing for you and for me and for Adam. In fact, God created work. God created work as a gift, not as a chore. In fact, he created it for a purpose. He didn't create it for pain. Another way you could say it is that work really was intended And we see this in Genesis 2. Work was intended to be a platform, but a platform for God's purpose. I mean, think about what we already know about it. When God created the garden, he created this beautiful, lush, perfect space. And don't forget that he's God, right? Like, he spoke light into being. I mean, the guy's pretty powerful. And so he puts Adam in the garden, and he says he needs him to work it. Well, why did he want Adam to work it? He doesn't need Adam to work it. Like, if the grass gets long, he's God. He just goes shorter, you know, and it's shorter, right? Like, guys, how great would that be in your yard? You know, like God's, he's God. He doesn't need Adam to do any of that. So why did he put him in there in the first place to work it and to take care of it? That's an important question to think about. Here's what I think. I think he put Adam in the garden to work and take care of it because God wanted to do something dynamic through Adam so Adam could understand a little bit more about the heart of God. Because when you are placed in the garden and it's your job to cultivate and to protect and grow and help create, it begins to help you understand a lot more about the heart of your Heavenly Father. See, God didn't need Adam to do it, but he wanted Adam to do it because he wanted to help Adam understand more about creation. He wanted Adam to understand more about cultivation, about growth. He wanted to help Adam understand more about their relationship. And as Adam kind of sat in the platform of Eden, working it and taking care of it, it was helping him find purpose in something bigger than him and helping him experience something bigger than him. God didn't need Adam, but he wanted Adam. It's a pretty incredible purpose. Of course, it only took him about one more chapter to mess the whole thing up. But from the very beginning, it had incredible purpose. And it was built on a platform that was specifically designed for Adam. So we've been asking this question in this series, like, how do we know if we're getting it right? And when it comes to work, I mean, the question, how can we know if we're getting work right? Well, the answer to that always has to come back to purpose. In fact, every week in this series, we've been talking about that if you want to understand how to get something right, you have to understand the purpose behind it. Because if you're not operating within the purpose of it, you're never going to get it right. And when it comes to work, that is so incredibly true. Because when it comes to work, we will never understand our purpose at work until we understand the purpose of work. Like when we're working for the weekend, if we don't ever understand the purpose of work, we're never gonna understand what it looks like to live out of that purpose. If we can't figure out God's original purpose, we're never gonna feel like we're not working for the weekend. We're always gonna be in that kind of 80%, dissatisfied, unhappy, no passion for what we're doing. But the reason we don't think about that is because we probably already feel like we know the purpose of work. Like if somebody came and asked you, hey, what's the purpose of your job? What's the purpose of work? You wouldn't say, I'm not really sure. God designed it, Genesis 2. I mean, you wouldn't say that, right? If somebody said, what's the purpose of work? You would go, well, I know what the purpose of work is. Some of you would say, well, it's to pay bills. Like, that's the purpose of work. Because every month, this bank, I hate them, they send me a mortgage. And I gotta pay it every month. So I go to work so that I can pay my bills. You know, I owe, it's off to work, I go. I mean, this is why I work. This is the purpose for me being at work. So some of us would say, well, no, it's kind of better than that. Like the purpose of work for me is just more. It's more money, more money, more money, more, more, more. Because I have like a vacation I wanna take in Europe for a month. It's just gonna take a lot more money. Like I've got that lake house I wanna get, that beach house. I got two lake houses and two beach houses. And you gotta get the boats and the skis and the tubes and the whole deal, you know what I mean? It's just, I'm working for that. Like I'm working for the weekend, but it's cool. I mean, I hate Monday, but Saturday's awesome on the lake. That's why I'm working. Like that's why. So some of you would say it's success. Like we would say that maybe you grew up in a home that was kind of real performance driven and you became an adult and you thought, well, I need to prove myself. Like I need to achieve, I need to persevere, I need to strive. And you took that adult striving into the workplace. And you've spent lots of years trying to be successful at work so that people would notice, so that maybe you would notice, so you could feel accepted or feel approved. Here's a real dangerous purpose. Some of us would say it's about our identity. Like some of us, if we really thought about it, we've in a way confused who we are and what we do. In fact, we've allowed what we do to define who we are. And when we allow what we do to define who we are, our identity is real circumstantial and really, really fragile. Because when you're doing well, you feel good about yourself. But what happens when things don't go well? What happens when maybe you get laid off? It's not even your fault. But what happens to your identity? When you don't meet that quota, or maybe a customer is frustrated. When your identity is built around what you do, man, it's real fragile. And the problem with these purposes is that they're so easy to live out of, yet they don't really provide anything better for us, do they? See, here's the reality. The people in the 80%, the people who are dissatisfied with work, I bet if we sat down with them, some of you are in that, and we said, hey, have you ever been able to not pay your bills like consistently? Most people would say, oh no, I mean, I can pay my bills. I mean, great, but I can do it. Have you ever got a raise? You ever got a promotion? Some people would say, oh my gosh, I've gotten like lots of raises, lots of bonuses. I have the title, I have the corner office. I'm still in the 80% club though, but I mean, I got all the more. I got more taken care of. I'm real successful. I hate Monday, but I'm real successful. See, the problem is that you can achieve all of these purposes and still hate Monday. You can achieve all these purposes and still hate work. Because what we really want is something bigger than that. We just don't really know it. What we really ache for is purpose, not a paycheck. We ache for purpose, not paychecks. And you know why I know that? It's because I spent a season of my life working in the marketplace feeling that. In fact, this weird kind of reverse inverted correlation would happen. In fact, the more paychecks I got, the less purpose I felt. The bigger the paycheck, the less purpose I felt. In fact, I remember the biggest paycheck I ever got leading me to wanting to quit my job because it felt like I was getting further and further away from discovering purpose. It was miserable. And if it was all about paychecks, I should be as happy as you could be. And I wasn't happy. And you know what? That isn't just me. I bet that's a lot of us. Because we ache for something bigger than that. So here's the real question. Here's the real question. If we want to get work right, if we really want to figure out how to find purpose, if we want to get work right, here's the question. What if the purpose of work is to show something, not to do something? What if the real purpose of work is to show something, not to earn something, or not to become something? What if the real purpose of work is bigger than even just the work itself? This guy that we've talked about a good bit, the Apostle Paul, he wrote all these great letters to the churches in the first century that he had planted in cities all along the Mediterranean rim. One of those cities is the city of Colossae, and he wrote this book that we've labeled Colossians as to the Christians in that city. And in that letter, he actually discussed work. But Paul had an interesting way of thinking about it. And what I love about his kind of thinking about it is he was on our side of Genesis 3. He was on our side of working for the weekend, of the 80%. We don't like work. We're miserable. We don't find purpose in it. We're getting paychecks, but it's not making us feel better. He was on that side of it. But he had an insight that few of us have. Because he saw work, I think, the way it was supposed to be seen in Genesis chapter 2. He saw something that maybe we were missing. He saw something he knew that those first century Christians, Jesus followers, were missing. So here's what he said to them, and I think he would say the same thing to us. He says, so whatever you do, and this little Greek word whatever is important, it means whatever. Like, whatever you do, including going to work, whatever you do, even going to work, whatever you do, do it, work at it with all of your heart as working for, now this is important because we would say money, success, identity, like work at it with all your heart because they've got a lot at stake. And that's what the people in the city of Colossae felt. That's what those Colossian Christians felt. And he says, no, it isn't about that. Whatever you do, work at it with all of your heart as if working for the Lord, not for human masters. Now I got to tell you, when they heard that, it was pretty confusing. And if we're honest, if we think about that, it's a little confusing for us too. I don't know about you, but when you interviewed for your job, I bet it was like mine, because when I've interviewed for jobs, Jesus never interviewed me. Satan once or twice, but never Jesus, right? Like when I'm interviewing for my job, it isn't like God was right there. Like God isn't the one on the other side of the desk when I'm having my performance review. Like God isn't there with me when I'm deciding, you know, if my boss decides if I'm getting a raise or a promotion, if I'm gonna get a new title, a new office. I mean, God isn't doing that. This is hard to fully embrace and imagine, but if you could go back 2,000 years ago, it was very real for them. It's real for us too. We don't think about it the same way, but then 2,000 years ago, it was so real for them. In these Colossian Christians, in these churches over there in that city, a lot of the people who were Christians were formerly Jewish people. A lot of them were Gentiles, but even the Gentile people understood how the Jewish God worked. And the Jewish God, they thought, lived in the ark, in the temple, in the Holy of Holies. The temple was over there. Work is over here. So when I go to the temple, I'm going to visit God. When I leave the temple, God stays in his home. I go on spring break. I'm grateful he stayed in his home, you know, because I'm doing my thing over here. And then if I mess some stuff up, it's cool. I'll take my pigeon. I'll go back to the temple. We'll deal with my sin. You know, good. God, are we good now? Sweet. I'm going to go sin some more, but you stay here. I'll be back. I mean, that's how they thought. And Paul says, I know that you think God is over there and you're over here, but here's what you need to know. When Jesus died and came back to life and he went to heaven, he ascended back to heaven, he said it was a good thing that he was leaving because the Holy Spirit was going to take his place here. And what he meant by that was that every single person who put their faith in Jesus would receive the Holy Spirit. So in a very literal way, not figurative, like in a literal way, everywhere you go, the temple goes with you because you are now the temple. You are the temple. Paul talked about that all the time. Which means when you go to church, the temple goes to church. And when you go to work, guess where the temple goes? Guess where God goes? To work. Because he's in you. Everywhere you go and whatever you do, God is with you. See, we don't see that, right? It's like since we don't see the Lord at our work, we just assume that the Lord doesn't have a place at work because we don't see him there. It doesn't feel like it does at church maybe, but the reality is that he is there. Because he's in you and he's with you. And when Jesus died, he didn't die just to redeem and forgive you so you could have a relationship with God. It's that, but it's more than that. I mean, in fact, Jesus gave his life to redeem your life, every part of your life. Jesus gave his life to redeem and restore and make new everything in you, all of the whatevers that you do, including work. I mean, think about this. When Jesus hung on the cross and he said, it is finished, he didn't just mean that I've taken all the sin of the world on my shoulders. It was more than that. It is finished means working out of Genesis chapter 3 can be finished. Living out of the fallen world can be finished. Experiencing all that came with sin, all of that can somewhat be moved aside because you now have an opportunity through faith to not just have a relationship with God, but for everything to be made new. Now, sure, I mean, it's not gonna be that easy. I mean, we still live in a fallen, broken world. We still make mistakes. There's still consequences for those mistakes. But in a very real way, we don't have to live like we're just working for the weekend. We don't have to work like we're just working for the weekend. In fact, I mean, if God didn't intend work to be about promotions and raises and offices and bonuses, I mean, what did he intend it for? Like what is the real purpose? If you go back to Genesis chapter 2, it's very clear that God really did create work as a platform with an incredible purpose. I mean, it's very clear. In Genesis 2, we see that God was building this platform for his honor, for his glory, for his kingdom to be made known all throughout the world and in the hearts and lives of every single person who would ever walk on this planet. And then Paul came along later and reminded the people. He said, hey, when you're working, you don't work for the boss. You're working for something way bigger than that. You're not working for sales quotas and for customers. It's way bigger than that. You're working for God, literally, because your work isn't about you. Your work is about something way bigger than you. Your work is about a platform. I mean, your work is a platform, but it's a platform for not your purpose. It's a platform for God's purpose. When you hear that, I know, I've sat in your seats before. When you hear that, you think, yeah, I mean, the pastor's work is about God's purposes. I'm trying to sell things. Like you work at a church, easy for you to say, right? But I mean, you know, I got quotas and clients and customers, and but Paul would go, no. Whatever you do, work at it as if you're working for God, not for men, because that's actually what a Jesus follower does. Because your work isn't really about your work. Your work is about a platform, and it's about a purpose. It's about the kingdom of God. It's about an opportunity for other people to be led into the kingdom of God. It's about other people to see something in you and to experience something through you that glorifies God, that honors God, that helps people move in the direction of their Heavenly Father. I love the way my friend Jeff Henderson says it. Jeff's the lead pastor at Gwinnett Church. Here's how he says it. He said that the purpose of your life at work is to show that God is at work in your life. That the real purpose of you being at work isn't to meet quotas, isn't to satisfy customers, isn't to make stuff. That the real purpose for you at work is to show that God is doing something in you. And when you allow God, when you allow other people to see that God is doing something in you, it will move those other people towards him. Because it brings him honor, it brings him glory. It's a kingdom thing. It's not a you thing. And when we begin to shift our focus away from what we do to why we do it, and we begin to understand the real greater purpose behind it, it's really, really hard to stay in that 80% group anymore. It is really difficult to be dissatisfied with Monday when you realize that Monday is an opportunity, because Monday is a platform with a purpose that God can use to change hearts and lives for eternity. It's way bigger than we ever thought. There are so many ways that we can kind of take that purpose into the marketplace, into work. I mean, one of them is just simply by just doing our best. Like showing up on Monday, desiring to do our best, because that's what God would do. God would do his best. And when we work hard and do our best, we in a very real way put on display God's heart to do well, to build, to create, to grow. It's like a very Genesis 2 Garden of Eden thing. When we cultivate beauty and we create great things, when we do our best, we, in a really cool way, get to show God off. Or maybe we walk in tomorrow and we just start thinking about how we can contribute to something way bigger than us. We don't go to work thinking about our promotions, our, you know, annual reviews. We don't think about our titles. We don't think about the things we want that we haven't got yet. We go in thinking about something way bigger than us. We walk in thinking about God's platform, and we think about God's purpose for work. Or maybe we just go in tomorrow thinking that we're going to treat other people as more important than us. Do you remember that moment before the crucifixion? It's the night before. And Jesus says, "A new command I give you, as I have loved you, so you need to love one another." They didn't understand what he meant, but the next day it was very clear, because he died for them. And he says, "I've died for you. I want you to love other people the way that I have displayed love to you." Now, let's just be honest. It's hard enough to go to work and just not treat other people the way that they treat you. Because at work, we often aren't treated very well. It's a lot more difficult to go to work and treat other people who are treating us poorly the way God would treat them. I mean, that seems almost impossible. But if we can begin to move in that direction, can you imagine what God may open up in their hearts and in their minds and in their souls if they saw that? Or maybe we can just become the best healthy version of us at work. Like, what if part of our purpose at work was to display what healthy people look like? What if all you did tomorrow was start working to separate who you are from what you do? Like, what if we could walk into work on Monday morning with like a full foundation that who I am is a child of God? What I do doesn't change that at all. That'd be a game changer for our purpose. And here's a big one. Maybe we could just start sharing our faith more. Maybe we could invite people to Woodstock City or another church like ours. I get that that's hard for some of us, right? I mean, some of us have HR policies against doing that. I get it. Can I just tell you, I worked in some of those places. One of my very first jobs was working in a consulting company. I was based in the Atlanta office, but we traveled all over the place. And I remember one day thinking, I wonder if God could use me here as he uses like pastors and churches and all that. Like maybe God put me here for a reason. So one day I remember praying, I'm like, hey God, like, you know, I'd like to maybe help share something about my faith. If that's cool, I don't know how to do that. I don't even know what the words are. Like, I'm not good at this stuff, but man, if you give me an opportunity, I'll do that. I remember I prayed that one day. And about a month later, I'm on a business trip. We went to Baltimore. There's about 10 of us went to Baltimore. And we, on a Tuesday night, I think, we were at a dinner with the clients. And then we were all coming back to our hotel room. And me and this guy, we had kind of shared a rental car. And so we were riding back together. He was driving. I was in the passenger seat. And he looks at me on the way back. It's about a 15-minute trip back to the hotel. He looks at me and he says, hey, he goes, I have a question for you. And I'm like, yeah, sure, whatever. He said, you just seem more happy than everybody else here. He goes, why? He goes, I know that you don't make more money than me. I'm a manager. You're not even a manager. I make more money than you. I get more perks than you. I have a better car than you. And I'm like, dude, shut up. Like, stop reminding me of how much better you are than me, you know? And he goes, why is it? Because I have all, have you beat in everything that the world would say is success. Why are you so happy? I remember thinking, uh-oh, this is what I prayed for, you know? Like, I didn't think you were paying attention, you know? What am I going to do? And so I remember thinking, I looked at him and I said, hey, would it be cool if I just shared a little bit about my faith? You know, would you mind if I did that? And he goes, no, I don't care. Tell me whatever. Whatever you got, tell me what it is because I need it. So on the way home, we just spent the rest of the trip talking about faith. I talked to him about growing up in the church and how I had to unlearn some things and relearn some things, but how at the core of everything that someone came to this world, died on a cross, rose again. There's too much evidence to prove that it happened. I can't answer everything else about floods and dinosaurs, and I mean, I don't know, but I'm just telling you, somebody died and came back to life. I just follow that guy. I mean, that's what I do. And at the end of the trip, we pulled into the hotel, parked the car. He was in tears. We got out. He says, we just go to the hotel pool, and I baptized him. I'm just kidding. None of that happened. That didn't happen. We got to the hotel. We pulled in. There was nobody crying. We pulled in. He opened the car and he got out. I got out. I was like, hey, do you have any questions? You know, I was like real excited. He was like, no, I'm good. And he went to his room. I went to my room. The next morning, I thought, but God's going to work on him overnight. You know, he's not going to sleep. He's going to be super tired. The next morning, we show up. He looks real well, you know, rested. I'm like, oh, that's a bummer. You know, did you sleep good last night? He's like, oh, man, I slept great. I'm like, really? Okay, so we got in the car again. I'm like, hey, so do you have any questions about what we talked about last night? He's like, what did we talk about? And I was like, oh, okay, thanks God, you know, for that opportunity. You know what I realized? What I realized is that God's platform and his purpose is more about seed planting than changing lives. And in fact, Paul talked about that. Paul talked about how he planted seeds and a guy named Apollos, who was like him, watered, but it was God who was responsible for making things grow, not us. And I never found out what happened to that guy. In fact, we didn't work on the next client together. I never saw him again, and I don't know where his faith is. I do know. I do know that in that car, in that moment, there was a platform with a real purpose, and it would have been very easy to ignore it. But God didn't put me in that car to satisfy clients and to make money. I really think he put me in that car because he has a greater purpose. I think that's probably true for all of us. I think every single one of us has been positioned where we are on purpose for a purpose. And the purpose is bigger than us. The purpose is the kingdom of God. Because you know what God cares the most about? He cares more about having a relationship with people far from him than anything else. And in the workplace, in the marketplace, we have incredible opportunities to help people find their Heavenly Father. Paul knew that was true. In fact, at the end of this little passage, he kind of gives us a promise. He says that whatever you do, work at it as if you're working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know, he says, you know this is true, you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. I don't exactly know what that inheritance and reward is. I mean, I could guess. I think that if you did your best, if you treated other people the way Jesus would treat them, if you thought about others first, thought about the bigger thing more than your thing, I have a pretty good feeling that will lead to more money, more promotions, titles, corner offices. I mean, you'll probably get all that just by being a good person. Like, all that might happen. And maybe that is the reward. Maybe that's it. Or maybe the reward is way bigger than that. Like, maybe the reward is sitting in church one day and having a coworker tell you thank you for inviting him. Maybe the reward is one day sitting in here and a baptism video comes on and the person names you because you decided that work was not about you, that it was a much bigger purpose with a platform that God could use to change people's lives. Like maybe ultimately it's about the small things, maybe it's about the real big things. I'm not really sure. Here's what I am sure of. I am absolutely certain that when we begin to look at work through the platform and the purpose of Genesis chapter 2, we will show up on Monday with a renewed peace, with a renewed passion, a renewed heart. And no matter what happens in our work, we will see the greater purpose of our work because God will redeem and restore it. And he might just redeem and restore the people around you in the process. And you know what? That's probably worth leaning into. Hey, so before we leave, I'd love to take a second and pray with you guys. Heavenly Father, it seems weird to say thank you for work because when we hear that word, we kind of shirk away and we don't really love it. But man, when you created work, you created it to be beautiful and to be purposeful and to be a platform for your kingdom. And I guess the good news, bad news about that, God, is no matter where we are, no matter how much we love what we're doing, you can do something in us and through us, no matter where we are. So God, for those of us that love our jobs, I pray that we'll see our jobs as more than just that work that we do. And for the majority of us, if we're to believe the stat, for the majority of us that don't love Monday, that don't love what we're doing, we feel like we're just working for the weekend, I pray that you will redeem that in us and you will help us understand what your original intent for work was. And maybe we can show up to our workplace with a much greater purpose and see it as a platform for you to do the most amazing things in the kingdom. So God, thank you for our jobs. Thank you for work. Thank you that we get to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. And it's because of Jesus that we get to do that. And so in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I hope you all found today's message helpful and eye-opening. We have some discussion questions at the end of our video. You can discuss it with your family or friends or even your coworkers at work and learn their perspective of work. Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope you have a great week, and we will see you next week. God bless.